Welcome to St. John's. If you are new visiting with us today or coming back after a vacation, hey, Tamari. He said something to me. Can't hear? It's on. How about that? Are we on? Okay, couple of brief announcements. I know Bob has some. Bob, do you want to come up and go first? I think you have to breathe on this.
Good morning. Our church council secretary is moving from the area. Our church council secretary has moved, and we are seeking another council member. So if anybody's interested in going on council, let me know. Also, we need one person for the audit committee. So if anybody's willing to step up to be on the audit committee, I would appreciate it. Our organ renovation campaign has surpassed the goal of $50,000. It will continue until the end of this year, and I would like to especially thank Steve Ware for spearheading that campaign. So thank you all for all your contributions, and we really surpassed our initial goal of $50,000.
And following up on the organ renovation program, any monies that do come in will be in a account for that future. That helped this year when we wanted to do the organ. We already had in our savings a chunk of money. And you guys all know I'm not good with numbers, so I forget how much. But there was a lot of money that they used to restart this that campaign. So if organ is your passion, don't feel like you have to stop giving to the organ fund. It will just be put in place for that. Happy long July 4th weekend. But next week is when we celebrate Heritage Day. I know Steve has a sign-up sheet out there. There are still some openings for people to come and help. As he has mentioned, you don't have to have done it before in order to sign up. You will be trained in everything you need to know. It is giving tours in here. It is being down in the grain cellar, which is very cool, almost air conditioned light. And what's the third one? Greeters at the door. I am coordinating the parking. Some of our youth are away, unfortunately, but anybody who'd like to help park, all of that, those monies go into the youth account. Victor and I will be here for most of the day on that. Are there any other announcements?
Thank you to everybody who took the twister circles off the twister board. One more thing, we are serving a meal at Vacation Bible School this year. So if you would be so kind possibly as to take a dinner card, so you'll see on the back, this is a black case, and bring whatever is listed on the back of it. So this one says 12 fruit or applesauce cups. So if you can bring that to the church, to St. John's by 2 o'clock on the day that's listed on the runout. So each day is a specific meal, and there are specific items that are needed. So if you can take these, it would be greatly appreciated. Please feel free to sign up if you have kids or grandkids for Vacation Bible School. It will be a fun time.
And that starts next Monday, not tomorrow, a week from tomorrow. So this is happening very, very quickly. Summer, right? Happy July. So without any other announcements,
Thank you.
bulletin. Please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose words never fails, whose promise is sure. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another, our neighbors. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cold cup of water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The opening hymn is hymn 876.
Lord, have mercy.
first lesson is a reading from the 28th chapter of Jeremiah. The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priest and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to his place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsibly Psalm 89. Your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness.
For I am persuaded that the years that I have followed is the sacrifice forever. You have set your faithfulness firmly in the house.
I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath the day of my servant. You are the people who know the vessel shall and walk over in the light of your presence.
They rejoice in your name. They are joined with your righteousness.
For you are the glory of our strength, and by your favor our might is exalted.
Truly our shield belongs to the Lord, our King to the Holy One of
the second lesson is a reading from the 6th chapter of Romans. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey your passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been free from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and the children are invited to go to the nursery. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you were to ask me what I like to watch on television, when I have time, I tell you, I would tell you that I like to watch sports. Baseball, football, and college basketball at the top of the list. And then I would say reality TV, but not Survivor or American Idol or Big Brother or The Real Housewives of New Jersey. But the ones on the National Geographic Channel or the Discovery Channel, and especially the ones where people, whether as an individual, families, or even just as a couple, are living in the remote wilderness of Alaska, where their homes are often accessible only by boat, float plane, or maybe only by foot, or sled dog in the wintertime. Maybe you've seen some of these shows, like Below Zero, The Last Alaskan, or Alaska, The Last Frontier, though they're a bit more civilized than some of the others. And if you ever watched one of these shows, you know the challenges that they face to survive. Bitter cold, blinding snow, the lack of food, and an abundance of predators, the dangers of falling trees for firewood to provide heat, and the rushing of water in the creeks and rivers as they're boating and fishing, the power of water that can sweep you away at any moment. Living in remote Alaska comes with what I imagine is an immense feeling of freedom. There's no one nearby to tell you what to do or how to do it. You are free from living in a society that says you need more, that you need more money, a bigger house, or a newer car. You are free from being tied down to a 9-to-5 job that isn't fulfilling, though your job is survival, and that's 24/7 in Alaska. And as you live in such a remote place, you must be fiercely independent. You must be willing to battle Mother Nature and all she can throw at you to survive. There's no one else to call on in your time of need. The only person that you have to depend on is you and your family or your spouse if they are there. There is no picking up the phone and calling 911 and having the police or ambulance show up in a matter of minutes. You may be waiting hours or days for the Coast Guard or state troopers to get there with a helicopter, as it all depends on the weather. I think oftentimes we long to have that freedom and independence. And yet, as we approach the 4th of July holiday on Tuesday, and we celebrate the independence of the United States, and the accompanying freedoms that we have, the enjoyment of backyard barbecues, and the obnoxious amounts of fireworks being launched all day and all night, I am again reminded that freedom doesn't mean that we get to do whatever we want or when we want. Our actions have consequences. As Newton's third law of motion says, when an object exerts a force on another object, that second object exerts an equal and opposite force on the first one. And with those freedoms we have, we also have a great responsibility. Responsibility to care for the world and those around us, to consider how our actions affect those of others. And as we celebrate this nation's independence, we are also reminded that we don't live in isolation. Our world is one that is interdependent. We live in communities of diverse people, with diverse backgrounds, with In Paul's letter to the Romans, we read that in and through Christ's actions, as we have been united with Christ in his death in baptism, we have been freed from the power of sin. We have been free to live obediently under God's grace. In being freed from the power of sin, we have been freed to serve. We have been freed for service in God's kingdom here on earth, to share the good news of Jesus Christ with others, to be Christ's presence wherever we find ourselves, to proclaim and to sing of God's faithfulness throughout the ages, to proclaim God's love which will last forever, to pursue righteousness, that is, to pursue living in right relationship with those around us, regardless of how we are different, to acknowledge and embrace that our lives depend, on the lives of the people in the communities in which we live, work, and play. But they also depend on the lives of those around the world who grow the food that we eat, who make the clothes that we wear, who build the cars that we drive, who extract cadmium from mines in South Africa for our smartphones, as Jim taught us in the adult forum several months ago. Our lives are truly dependent upon people around the world. And as we become more and more aware of that interdependence on those people around the world, and on the interconnectedness of the world in which we live, we are challenged and called to extend hospitality, to welcome those sent into our lives, to welcome them not just as an individual person, but as a representative of an entire family or people group, where we don't live only as individuals. We ourselves belong to and represent our families. We represent the groups with which we belong, to those around us. And it is these families and groups that have formed our identity. But it isn't only that we are called and challenged to extend hospitality to those around us. There will be times when we are the ones that are sent out, where we are the ones that are asked to serve as representatives of the families and groups of which we are a part, where we are challenged to accept hospitality from someone else, to receive thy grace. These are times when we are asked to be Christ's presence in the places and spaces to which we are called. And it is here, in this act of welcoming, of extending hospitality to one another, and to the act of being welcomed by others, that our identity and beliefs are shaped and formed. And as the awareness of our interdependence increases, we can see how the diverse people God has sent into our lives has impacted and changed our identity and the sense of community that we have. We can see how those God has sent into our lives has challenged us to expand our view of who God has already named and claimed as a beloved child of God. And it is in God's kingdom, where all are welcome, that we are truly free. So on this long 4th of July weekend, as we celebrate independence and freedom, I hope that you remember that true freedom isn't found on earth. It is only found in God's kingdom. It is only found in Christ, who in baptism has freed us from the power of sin and freed us to serve in the kingdom of God with Christ leading. And it is Christ who meets us. Christ who leads us. And we meet Christ here at the Lord's table tonight, where each of us, all of us, are strengthened and nourished to continue living into that freedom as we journey with Jesus. I invite you to stand as we sing our hymn of the day, number 802.
For courage to welcome people who desire society. resolve to serve all the needy. God, be merciful.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for creation, for all rivers, lakes, oceans, and streams. The living spirit of saints force you to be drought for wildfires. For conservation efforts and clean energy solutions. God, be merciful.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for those in need, for exiles, immigrants, refugees, and those seeking asylum, for victims of harassment or abuse, for all those who are ill and in pain, including those we mention our prayers, Alita, Chuck, Sandy, Richard, James, Christopher, Harold, Lorraine, Pastor Warren, Terry, Miriam, Jane, Kamala, Tom, Ryan, our homebound family and friends, and the family and friends of Earl, Gavin Dean, and Nelson Mount, along with those who may allow it in our hearts. God, be merciful.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for children for their safety. You have blessed us with the joy and responsibility of children. As we care for them, give us gracious love, calm strength, and patient wisdom, that we may teach them to love whatever is just and true and good. God, be mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all colleges and universities as they become places of good learning, and also as they rework and refit, making admission fair for all, and they welcome all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
We are invited to share a sign of that peace with one another.
sea and sky. You are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace, live in love, as Christ.